Welcome to Psychic Social, brought to you by psychic.co.uk.
On this episode of Psychic Social.
I've been doing with someone recently who's got mental health problems. We've been doing like deep meditations and it's helped him no end. In fact, he said that after the first session, he said that he had the two best days he's had in like 20 years.
Welcome to Psychic Social with me, Oliver Duke, the podcast that explores all things from the psychic and spiritual perspectives, including interviews with famous psychic practitioners, discussions about the afterlife, the paranormal, and much more. So relax and enjoy the show. Today's guest has been a psychic medium for nearly three decades. He has the ability to connect with spirit loved ones and has the art of prophecy to help guide people on their earth path. He also has the honour of connecting with the angel realms, blending with him and enlightening him with the ability to scan people's souls, locate ailments, and advise on the best way forward for them. His passion lies in educating people in the spirit world, the angel realms, and is at his happiest when he's helping people regain health through holistic practice and diet. He truly believes that the body and soul can be healed by mediumship, psychic and physical healing, behavioural adjustments, and life coaching. The person I'm talking about, and today's guest on Psychic Social, is Richard Morley. So let's get to know much more about him right now. Hi, Richard, and welcome to the show. How are you today?
Yeah, I'm not too bad. Thank you very much. Excited about being on here.
Great stuff. Well, we're excited to have you on Psychic Social. What have you been up to today?
Well, I was meant to be in Devon visiting my sister Nikki, but because of the severe sort of weather warnings and actually shut off quite a few roads, I've had to stay in sunny old Southend-on-Sea. So I was meant to be doing a few readings today for people in Devon, but I haven't been able to do that. So I'm at home actually having a nice chilled day off, actually.
Great. Okay. Well, it's a shame, isn't it? But you didn't get to make it down there. This is Storm Dennis, I take it, that we've just had.
Yeah, Storm Dennis. Yeah, well, Nikki rang me on the day we was meant to go down there, and she said that it's actually ripping the coast up. So it's a good idea not for me to go down there because it's too dangerous. So unfortunately, I had to stay in Southend.
Probably best not. Yeah, to go. Yeah. Okay. Well, it's great to have you on the show. We'd like to kick off the show with our first question to you, and that is for you to take us back to the start. We wanted to ask you, how did you become a psychic? Was this passed down from a family member or grandmother or mother? Or was there another way the gift came to you?
It's all in the family, to be honest. As I said, Nikki's a psychic medium. My sister Sarah is a psychic medium as well. My mum was a medium, but she lost faith when my dad passed, so she stopped working. And my granddad, my dad's dad, was a seventh son of a seventh son. He's the most spiritual guru I'd ever met, you know. So it was all in the family. And even from a young age, when I was around sort of five, I was walking around the house, and I remember because my mum stopped me, I had like a knife, like a pen opener, like an envelope opener. And I was running around the house with that. And mum said, "What's the matter?" I said, "Oh, someone's broken in." This is at the age of five. But I was seeing spiritual people, but I thought there was people in the house. So it started from a very early age. And it's always been like a way of life, really, for us. It's always like normal. Right. So it's kind of started there. So it's just been like a normal thing for me. As in actually working as a medium, I've only been doing it for the last couple of years, but up to then, I was doing readings, but you know, like professionally, I've only been doing it for a couple of years now.
Okay. So just rolling back to what you were saying when you were a child, what sort of things were you seeing? Were you seeing shadows or actual apparitions or solid people, or what was manifesting in front of you?
A bit of everything, really. I mean, my intuition was very good there, so I was feeling a lot. You know, I was feeling a lot of spirit people, but I did actually see people like walking past my room. And there was always, when I was standing at the top of the stairs, I used to see people walk past the bottom of the stairs and walk into the lounge all the time. So I'd run down there to see who it was, but then I couldn't see them. So it was a bit of everything, really, to be honest.
Right. Okay. And as a psychic, do you work clairvoyantly, clairsentiently, clairaudiently, or all three, or a mixture of those? How does it work with you?
It's a mixture of everything, really. You know, like you say, sometimes you just sort of feel what's right to say, what to say. Sometimes I'll see things. I do lately, more so lately, I've really been smelling a lot of things. Right. So for instance, the other day I was doing a reading and a real, real strong smell of tobacco smoke come through, and I said, "Well, he used to smoke roll-ups, this guy," and it was you could smell the sort of strong tobacco that you smoke. And she's like, "Yeah," but it was more so lately I've been getting that a lot, where the smell of, you know, of the person or the perfume, all that lot's coming through. So, yeah, that's been quite good. It's been a bit of an upgrade.
Right, okay, that's very interesting. So you're seeing, you're hearing, and you're sensing, and you're smelling as well.
Yeah.
All at the same time. Wow, that's very interesting. Now, on your website, we can see there's lots of stuff going on there. We sort of get the impression there's very much a holistic approach to your psychic work. Can you tell us a bit more about that?
Yeah, well, I'm actually a health intuitive, so I'll pick up on ailments that they've had in the past and stuff that's going on with their health as well at the moment. And I'll also get a feeling for what sort of medication they should be taking, because sometimes I just get the name of the medication pop in my head, or what supplements they should be on, and also diet changes that will help them as well. So I've been doing that for a while now, and it's been quite good. I've had some quite positive results from that as well, and it's been nice because I've helped quite a few people like get well, and also within that I also pick up on any sort of negative energy, as in like depression energy, that sort of thing, and so we can work on that side of things as well. Mm-hmm. which is always good, because there's obviously a fine balance between the body and the mind. Mm-hmm. So that way if we work with both of them, we can get their health back up. Or, you know, I'm not saying that I can cure people, but I'm saying that I can help them to relieve certain symptoms.
And you can steer them on the right path as such. So potentially if they're not taking, you know, the medication that might be helping them from the doctor, you can tell them to go back to the doctor and maybe sort of suggest, you know, that they should try this or try that, or something that you might have suggested through your psychic visions or work with that person.
Yeah, that's right. And the other thing is, obviously, me and Nikki, we both suffer from a stress-related condition like ME. And I get a lot of people come to me from that. And also, because of my life experience of that as well, I've helped a lot of people with that as well. So it's really good to be in a position where I can help people in that respect. Like I say, I'm not a doctor or anything like that. Mm. But like you said then, sometimes I'll get a feeling that their medication might need to be reviewed, you know, and things like that. So they go back and then they change their medication. They start to feel better that way as well. So it's all good, because obviously, you know, you're helping people to sometimes get back to work or get back into their life because they've been so unwell.
Yeah, that's great, isn't it, to help people, you know, get back on the right track and like you say, get back to work or, you know, not be at home anymore unwell. And in terms of the supplementations, does this come to you through your guides or through your senses to tell them what type of supplements they should be getting, or are you using some of your experience that you've learned about supplements to help them along the way, or is it being fed to you? So this person needs to be on vitamin D or something like that.
Yeah.
Are you told that through a guide or something like that, or how does that work?
Yeah. Well. I think it works both ways actually there, because obviously I've helped a lot of people, so I sort of get a feeling of what they should be, you know, to help them with certain ailments. But I do get because I work with angel realms, you see, so I do get a lot of like supplements and that sort of basically placed in my head. For instance, there's one which was like cactus. I was like, I'm getting cactus, you should be taking cactus. And I thought, actually, you can't eat cactus. Mm-hmm. Surely that ain't good for you.
It's gonna hurt.
And then when I googled it afterwards, it's actually used for pain relief, and it's a supplement.
Right.
So I get that a lot of the time. Also, I get what I call triggers. So if I get a woman, for instance, drinking a glass of red wine, for some reason that means that there's like a hormone problem, like a hormone imbalance or something like that.
Right.
So they've sort of worked with me on these little triggers to help me sort of get through the reading and to get on the right path with people, basically, with their health issues.
Mm-hmm. It sounds very interesting, yeah. You're taking the full approach to actually helping these people, obviously in conjunction with their doctor, like you say, and the supplementation. It sounds great. Now it's going to move me on to my next question, which was, what's the most important thing to you about being a psychic? I think you briefly touched on this already, but tell the listeners a bit more about what's the most important thing to you about being a psychic.
Earlier I said helping people, basically. So if I can, obviously, mediumship and healing, it's the same sort of thing for me, really, because obviously if you're grieving someone who's passed, and then I bring them through for you, and you get a nice you know, sort of sense of relief that they're well up there and they're doing fine. And then they also come through and they help you with your, you know, your life and whatever's going on with you at the time. Then to me, that's healing as well, you know. So it's the whole healing aspect, healing, you know, the mind, the body, the soul, and helping people through their life, because, you know, life isn't easy, to be honest. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes just by, you know, getting mum, dad, or your brother through, and knowing that they're okay, and also proving that it's actually them, you know, it's just a big relief for people. And when people say to me, you know, that's helped me a lot, or, you know, I feel much better about this now, and thank you for helping me with my health or whatever, it just makes me feel good. And it is the best part of the job. As I say to people all the time, it's the best job in the world. It's the best job I've ever done.
Well, it's wonderful to help people, isn't it? If you can, no matter what you're doing. But if you're doing it for a living, even better, isn't it? Now, obviously, we've spoken to your sister on Psychic Social, Nikki Allen. We're talking to her about her guides and who they were. Do you have your own guides, personal guides? And if you do, how many do you have?
All right, so I've got this really beautiful Indian woman that's always been with me. Well, say always, I think for the last sort of 10 years she's been with me. And she's actually a brother of one of Nikki's guides. She came through to me whilst we was doing a trance meditation, and she's stuck with me. But I have, she's always there, but I have other guides come in and out all the time. And I think it depends on stuff I'm going through, or what sort of upgrades I get, if you like, or, you know, what stage I'm going through with the people that I'm working with as well. So, but she's always with me. She's the one that really helps me with my health intuitive work as well. But she's always there. But I'd like to say I always have different guides coming in. Sometimes they bring knowledge, you know, and sometimes, like I said, they bring me sort of different aspects to what I'm doing as well, you know, sort of like, say, little upgrades and things like that. So
you have that works with me. They'll come and go, so you won't have like two set guides or three set guides or one set guide. The different ones will come and go, is that right?
Yeah, that's right. So like I say, I always have the one guide. She's always with me. But I do get, I mean, they might stay with me for months, you know, they might even stay with me for a year or so, but they do change. They do swap and change.
Okay, that's very interesting. Okay. Now, my next question to you was, are there any heartwarming stories that stand out from any of your readings over the years?
Heartwarming stories. there was one lady who was really suffering with her health. She'd been diagnosed with, like, fibromyalgia, but she'd also had really bad reactions to... She couldn't even wash her hair. She couldn't even rinse her hair with like water. She had to use bottled water because it would just bring her skin up and it'd be painful. She couldn't use makeup or anything like that. So the first time I saw her, we changed her diet, put on the right supplements. That kind of helped her sort of 50-60%. And then there was a drug that sort of popped into my head whilst I was doing another reading, and she's done that, and she's like doing so much well now. It's unbelievable. She's sort of back at work. She's sort of 90% back to health, and she's just so much more happier. So to me, that's, you know, it's not like heartwarming, but to me that means that I've, you know, job done, basically. I've done a good job. And there's quite a few, you know, little stories like that where people are sort of back, you know, where they should be, like working and enjoying life. Another one that comes to mind was, there was this lady that had booked a reading with me, and I didn't realize her dad had only passed like a week ago, and he came through really strong for her. It was almost like he was standing next to me. It was a really good reading, and she kept on having more readings, and it came apparent to me that she was sort of living through me so she could sort of, you know, sort of keep her dad alive, if you like. And her energy wasn't too good. She was quite depressed because she absolutely loved her dad. And it was basically her life. And this is where it's quite good where I work with Nikki, because I was sitting there and I thought, do you know what? I'm going to have to tell her that she can't have any more readings because she needs to grieve. And as I thought that, the words Prism Living come in, and it's a course that Nikki does that helps people with grief and helps you get your energy back up and sort of move on with your life and things. Really good for people that have depression issues. And she used to be so upset and her energy used to be so low when I used to talk to her on the phone. Anyway, I put her on this course and I said, look, I'm not going to be able to do readings for a while because I want you to grieve. I put her on this course, and then she did book another reading with me, and I thought, oh God, here we go. She's not done it. And anyway, when I picked up the phone, she was like, hello. I was like, whoa, your energy's changed. You seem a lot happier. She went, yeah, I feel great. You know, the course is brilliant. You know, I'm loving it. And, you know, I feel a lot better about Dad now. And everything's great. And everything's brilliant. And that just, again, it just felt like job done. I'm really happy for you. And it just again, it's that warm feeling of like, you know, I've helped someone. And it's brilliant.
Really lovely. It must feel really fulfilling for you to have those kind of stories to tell and to experience that, you know, a lot, I should imagine, probably almost on a daily basis.
Yeah, that's it. And that's like I said earlier, it's the best job ever. Yep. And like I say, to get paid to it. I always say to people, if I was a multimillionaire, I wouldn't even charge for it. I'd just do it and it'd just be...
Why wouldn't you? Exactly. Yeah, for sure. Well, that moves us nicely into the break. We're hearing some great stuff from Richard Morley, the psychic here. And we're going to catch up with some more stuff from Richard and some more stories from him in part two. So we'll see you after this.
This is Psychic Social, where the world's best psychics tell you their story.
Hi, hope you're enjoying the show today. Now, we have a brand new horoscope email you can subscribe to at psychic.co.uk. All you have to do is wait for the pop-up to show on the website and then enter your email and star sign, and every Sunday night we'll email you a free horoscope for the week ahead. Now, you can dive in one step further if you wish and take a look at our Horoscope Plus memberships. This is your weekly horoscope plus a lot more. There are three memberships to choose from, and we've covered all budgets, we feel. So the Robin membership gives you private exclusive access to a more detailed horoscope on the member horoscope pages at the website, and a chance to win a psychic reading via Zoom each month. And you'll get a free access code as well to the taster version of our amazing video tarot course with Nikki Allen, 10-Hour Tarot. Now, this membership is just £1.99 per month, and you can cancel it anytime you like. There's a ton of stuff in there for such a small amount of money, so much value. The next membership we've got is the Feather membership. It's a step up from there, and it's just £5.99 per month, and you can also cancel anytime for that one too. Now, as a Feather member, you'll get a much more detailed, in-depth horoscope than the Robin membership horoscope. And on that Feather member horoscope page on the website, you'll get exclusive access to that, with over 1,000 words of horoscope broken down into three sections. That's including romance, work, and family. It really will give you a fantastic insight into the week ahead every single week. You'll also get our truly amazing astrology video that's thrown in for free as well, which is 30 minutes of fantastic content on astrology. And as with the Robin membership, you'll also get a chance to win a psychic reading via Zoom every month too. So that's wonderful value in there as well for $5.99 a month for the Feather membership. And the final membership is the Angel member. That's the top level membership to access on the site. That gives you some amazing stuff, and all that info is on the website. Just head to psychic.co.uk/membership and take a look at which one will suit you. We'll put the link in the show notes of this podcast down below for you, so you can just click there and check them all out there. You can also check out the horoscope page and have a little sneak peek at what the Robin members are getting there already. That's at psychic.co.uk/horoscope. Right, now back to the show.
This is Psychic Social, the spiritual home of psychics.
Welcome back to part two of Psychic Social and our chat with Richard Morley. Now, continuing on from the last question before the break, I have another one for you here, and it was, are there any funny or hilarious stories that really stood out for you from any of your readings?
Funny or hilarious? I'll tell you what was funny. Me and Nikki, we do like live feeds on Facebook, and this time we actually tried to do it on YouTube, and because our ratings got so high, the live feed went up to all the people that do all the gaming, because like they do all the live feeds on gaming, don't they? Mm-hmm. And so we had gamers on there, and they started going on there and writing stuff. And what happened was this one guy, and the stuff he was writing, it was really rude, but it just was so funny that as I was reading it, I just started laughing, and Nikki's like, what are you laughing at? And we're in the middle of a reading. It was really unprofessional, to be honest, but we're in the middle of this reading. Nikki, what are you laughing at? And I went, look at that. And we started laughing so hard that we had to we couldn't carry on with the reading. We was actually rolling around. It's all on Facebook.
Right, okay. This.
We're actually rolling around, like, laughing so hard. And he carried on. And in the end, he got the ump because he was trying to upset us.
Right.
But we found it funny. And I actually said, you can come back again. And I invited him back because it was so funny. So he didn't sort of have the desired effect that he wanted. But we laughed. And to be honest, everybody that was watching it, they all found it funny as well. They was all sort of cracking up as well. But right. that was quite good.
So they were trying to troll you as such on YouTube?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. They were trying to troll us, but it didn't work.
Didn't work,
it just made us laugh.
Too much love and light. There you go. Exactly, right. Okay. My next question to you off the back of that was, this is something that we ask every guest that we have on Psychic Social, and that is, what are your thoughts and feelings about the afterlife and what happens after we leave Earth?
Right, okay. So, for me, I've always thought that, you know, there's like one place where we go and there's one place where we are. And I sort of stand in the middle and I'm, you know, the conduit. I can talk from people from one side to the other. And I'm the medium. I'm the one in the middle that's passing the information. And I always thought of it as black and white. And then Nikki started talking to me about angels. And I've never been one that's been sort of, you know, to read the Bible and thought about God and angels and all that sort of stuff. I had some experiences a little while after she started talking to me about it that made me believe. I mean, I'd have to write a book about it. I can't even go into it here. It's such a long story, but it was so powerful that it just changed my life. And I was like, yeah, I believe in angels now, definitely. So I know that there's angel realms. I know that they help us work. And I know that they look after us. And as soon as people accept that, their lives get better. I've seen it happen a lot of times. Mm. But yeah, I do believe that we go to another place. I don't believe it's anywhere near anything like our material world here. I know for a fact that there's no such thing as time there. Time's like a human thing. Mm. It's not, you know, that's not there. And I know that because they've spoken to me about that during meditations and things. So, and I believe that, you know, I had one guy say, oh, you know, what's my dad wearing when he's up there and all that lot? And I said, well, I'll tell you what he's wearing now, but this is just for you so that you can connect with him. I said, but there's, you know, they don't sort of get up in the morning and put clothes on and all that. It's a total different kind of thing. We're a different sort of entity there. We have soul recognition with each other up there. It's not facial or anything like that, because obviously I believe as well that we live different lives. So we can, you know, live in a different time period. We can live different lives. And it's not like, as like I said about the linear time thing, that's only a human thing. That's not.
That's man-made, isn't it? Time. It's obviously, yeah.
It's just so that we can organise ourselves. Well, they don't need that kind of organisation up there, you know. So, and that's why sometimes spirit come through. They'll show themselves during readings as a young person, you know, or they'll come through as, you know, how they looked before they passed. That sort of age. I have it quite a lot. I've actually had people whilst doing a reading come in, you know, when they're, you know, sort of just before they passed, and show me how they looked. And then they've come in again as a younger person. I'm thinking it's a different person coming in, and they've gone, actually, no, that's my uncle. When he's just showing you when he was younger, he's just right. Trying to sneak back in the reading again.
Right, okay.
So, that's what they do. So that's what I think of things, you know. I feel that we come down here just to experience, because in the spirit world, there's only the emotion of love. Mm-hmm. That's the only thing there is there. And I think we come here to experience all the other things, you know, all the other emotions. It's a little bit like, you know, basically playing a computer game, really. You know, you're sort of there controlling it, sort of, and then you're experiencing stuff that you wouldn't in the real world, you know. And that's how I see it, that we're actually coming down here just to experience stuff, because we can't experience it up there, because there's no such thing as hate or jealousy or anything like that, you know. So, and that's my look on it anyway. That's how I believe
sure.
it is.
And we're here to, from the understanding that I get from all the psychics I've spoken to on the show, is that we're here, like you said, you know, to do a job, to learn as well, to get a greater level of understanding from the existence that we take, in the life that we take, in whatever human form we take. And that may have happened, you know, hundreds or thousands of times in thousands of lives before, and it may go on after that until we learn a certain amount of things, number of things, and then we move up when we die in an incarnation and move on to somewhere else. Is that what you think would probably happen?
Yeah, I think so. I think that we choose our life path before we come here. So I think there's a certain amount of free will, but we definitely have definite times when something happens, when something changes in our life, you know. Mm-hmm. And I also believe that we ask people to jump in to make us sure that we are edged towards that, you know, sort of destination point each time. So yeah, exactly what you're saying, you know, we go ahead and it's all about, you know, we do a lot of learning. I think a lot of us, there's a lot of us that have come, that are put down here as earth angels, if you like, to sort of help everybody else and steer them. But like I say, I believe that there's a life path that we follow, but there is a certain amount of free will, but we always get edged back to what we're meant to be doing, how we know where we're meant to be eventually. So
yes, that's something that Nikki mentioned, I think, as well, about being on your path. You know, if you're veering off the path that you're supposed to be on, you get put back on it in some way, shape or form, whether that be by an angel or by, you know, another being, you know, that puts you back onto the path you should be taking.
Yeah, that's right. That's why I think we have friends that come and go.
Yeah.
You know, you sort of have people in your life that don't stay there forever, and, you know, and then they come and go, and they've helped you with whatever it is you need at that time.
Yeah.
And it could be the most smallest thing, you know, it can be the most smallest thing that sort of just gets you on there. It could be just a couple of words, and it just makes you change your approach to whatever situation, but they're just steering you in the right place again.
Yeah. Well, a couple of times you mentioned in the show so far about your meditations. Can you tell us a bit more about your meditations, what you do in those, and in terms of your connection to your spirit guides? Is it through the meditations, or how does that all work for you?
Okay, so what I do with my meditations, because I feel very sort of attuned to nature, if you like. So when I meditate, I always have sounds of nature on. I like to be sort of by a waterfall or a river. Lately I've been tropical rainforest sounds. I've been putting them on because I love the thunder and all the, you know, the rain coming down. It just really relaxes me. And as soon as I close my eyes, it brings me straight to the rainforest, you know. But I also like to meditate in the bath.
Right, okay. And with the rubber duck.
I get in the bath, put some candles around, get me tropical rainforest sounds on. Lay down in a nice hot bath. I'm topping the bath up. I've been in there for 3 hours before.
Really?
Topping the water up. Yeah.
You turn into a prune, no?
Yeah. Oh, gosh. Yeah, you do. Yeah, definitely. But I always put like Epsom salts and things like that in there as well, because it just relaxes you more, because the magnesium and that relaxes your muscles more. And I just drift off, and I connect with angel realms, or like you say, guides, depending on whatever it is I need to do. To me, meditation just sort of means clear mind, basically. So whatever I'm going through at the time, they might just bring me little hints of what I should be doing, you know, because especially like recently, because of like we've got these shows coming up and stuff like that, they've sort of been putting me in the right frame of mind and sort of helping me towards that kind of thing, because it's a different energy I'm working with. And I had the same thing, they sort of done the same thing with me when I started doing the live feeds as well, because it is a different energy every time. It's always like a different sort of way of working. So they've done that with me. But yeah, my meditations are, to be honest, I love them. I do what I call a healing meditation as well. Like I say, because I've got ME, if I'm having a particularly bad one and I'm crashing, I'll have a healing meditation. I will be in the bath for a couple of hours, but when I come out, I feel amazing. I feel much better, and I can move on, you know. I do the same thing with colds and stuff as well. If I get a cold, I'll eat sort of raw garlic and ginger and things like that, make some teas up and stuff, and I'll sit in there with my tea, get in the bath and do a healing meditation, and I feel so much better when I get out of the bath. It works on a lot of ways. Obviously meditation, as soon as you balance your mind and relax your body, you can just unravel all your life's problems, I believe. I've been doing one with someone recently who's got mental health problems. We've been doing like deep meditations, and it's helped him no end. In fact, he said that after the first session, he said that he had the two best days he's had in like 20 years.
Oh, fantastic.
He said, I didn't feel my heartbeat. And I thought, what? What do you mean you didn't feel your heartbeat? You know, thinking, oh my God, what have I done to him? And he said, because my anxiety is so bad, my heart like literally jumps out of my chest all the time. He said, but for 2 days, I couldn't feel that. I was like, brilliant. And that's what it's all about. And that's why I think meditation is a really important tool, whether you're spiritual or not, you know, whether you believe in, you know, God, Buddha, Superman, whatever, it doesn't really matter, because meditation is just clear. It just clears your mind. It helps to sort of heal the body. It's just a great tool just to get through life.
It's a really powerful thing. I mean, I've personally been meditating for over 10 years. And it's a really powerful thing, isn't it, when you can be able to get to the point where you can sit down for 10, 15, 20 minutes, if you can reach that long, and just be with yourself and your mind and your thoughts, and just close everything off and just, you know, just be. What would you say to people who, because I know I've got a lot of friends and family who don't meditate, and when I suggest, you know, the concept of it to them, they just say I couldn't even sit for a minute with their own thoughts. So what do you say to people who would want to try meditation potentially and in that sense and try and relax with their own thoughts? Is there a way, have you got a technique you teach people?
Yeah, well, basically, it's funny because when I do readings, I say to people, you know, you need to meditate. You need to sort of, you know, sort of connect up there and relax your body and your mind. And they go, oh, I can't meditate. I find it really hard to meditate. And I always say to them, meditation is personal. There's no real sort of, right way of doing it. You know, if you feel happy sitting under a tree, meditate underneath a tree. You know, if you feel happy sort of floating in a swimming pool, whatever you feel comfortable, whatever makes you feel comfortable and happy, do. You know, some people meditate to like Pink Floyd. You know, some people could meditate to heavy metal if they wanted to. It's all about whatever makes you feel comfortable and relaxed. And that's the main thing. You need to be relaxed. What I always say to people, a good way to start off sort of teaching yourself to go through the meditation, is to imagine a white light starting at your head and then going down your body. And each time it sort of, say it reaches your neck or your shoulders, you sort of mindfully think, are my shoulders relaxed? You know, and if they're rounded, then you sort of relax them. And as the light goes down, you think, oh, is my back relaxed? You know, are my arms relaxed? Until you get to your toes. Because in that way, you're basically telling your body to relax, sort of, and you're doing it consciously.
It's a body scan, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, basically a body scan, just to sort of make sure that everything is all sort of right. A lot of people, they say, oh, by the time I got to my stomach, I was away with the fairies anyway. Because, you know what I mean? They're concentrating. They're not thinking about anything else. They're not thinking about their everyday life stuff. They're not thinking about work. They're not thinking about kids. They're thinking about relaxing their body. And then, you know, it's just like me. If I sit and read a book, within about 5 minutes, I'm falling asleep. I can't read. I can't read books. It's just, I just start to read and it just relaxes me so much, I'm off, you know.
Yeah.
Again, you know, it's just finding the right thing. And like I say, sound, I think, is really important. I think sound is really important, because if you're sitting there just sort of laying on your bed and you start to sort of try and relax, and then you've got someone shouting outside or a police car goes past, it's going to be quite hard to concentrate. Later on, when you're meditating in that way, it won't bother you. You'll just see it as part of your meditation. So I think headphones are always a good thing. Music, like say nature sounds, that sort of thing, just to take you away from your space that you're in at the moment, is a real good thing to do.
Yeah, if you've got a particularly noisy space that you're in, or you live in the middle of an inner city or something like that.
Yeah.
I've learned a very good technique for meditating, when imagining an imaginary cloud going across the top of your head, and any thoughts that you have, because people, you know, when they try to meditate and they haven't done it before, they get lots of thoughts going into their head and they can't sort of, they're trying to clear their mind, you know, consciously, but obviously that's impossible. But what the technique was is just to let each thought flow up from the top of your head into the cloud and just fly off into the distance. And every time you had a thought, just let the thought go into the cloud and head off. And I found that quite useful, you know, to think of that while I was meditating.
Yeah, that's quite a good one. I'll use that.
it's good.
Another one I do is following a butterfly as well. That's another one, because, you know, sometimes when I take people into like a guided meditation, I'll get them to actually look at specific details, you know. So if I've got them in the woods, I'll say to them, there's a butterfly flying past, you know, sort of, what's the colour of the butterfly, you know, and that sort of thing, because then they sort of concentrate on that thing, which also, if they're concentrating on that, they're not thinking about other stuff, you know what I mean? So that works as well, I've found. So, I find that when I take people into guided meditations, the best place to take them is somewhere in nature, somewhere lovely, beautiful, and, you know, and sort of out there. I know one person who likes to be in the Arctic. They like to just be having snow around them.
Right, okay.
So it's just white, basically. They love that, you know. So, yeah, so it's personal. Like you say, it's personal. However, you know, like you say, you do your thing with the cloud. Some people do, like I say, with the butterfly. Some people like to be by a river, by the sea, or whatever. It's very personal. And that's what you've got to do. You've got to find what is good for you, what helps you to relax, and what helps you to sort of get through your meditation.
Yeah, and it's like, you know, you said, it's vitally important, I think, for everyone's mental health. And I think, if, was it the Dalai Lama said, if everyone meditated for 20 minutes every day in the world, in the next 50 years we'd eradicate war completely, you know. And yeah, I think that more people should try and make it part of their daily life, but you can only lead a horse to water, can't you? You can't make people do it, I suppose.
Exactly. I mean, I think, to be honest, sometimes it's better than like watching TV. It's like something you can do. Mm. It's like a pastime. You can actually go to the gym and have a little meditation now rather than watching TV or whatever. Yeah. It's actually something that you can get in and actually do, because it can be quite enlightening. You know, some of the things you see, some of the inspiration you get from what you do. You know, there's a lot of good poets and songwriters out there that meditate, and they get a lot of inspiration through it, you know. So it is important. And it's definitely, like you say, about the, you know, eradicating war. It does chill you. It does relax you. And it does make you notice as well and see that all the things you worry about in everyday life, you know, sort of money and work and relationships and that, like, they're not necessarily as important as what you think they are, you know. Because you just sort of, it takes you out of that space for a little while, then you sort of look at it and go, actually, is it that bad?
And you concentrate more on the present moment instead of, you know, when you're looking into the future, you're always anxious, aren't you? So when you're concentrating constantly, well, as much as you can on the present moment, then the anxiety becomes less, doesn't it?
That's it, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely right. That's right, yeah.
Well, that's all very interesting stuff, I'm sure. I mean, I could talk to you about meditation for the next 2 hours probably, but we can't, unfortunately, because the show has a time limit. So we'll leave that stuff there. And we're now going to ask you some unrelated psychic stuff and unrelated meditation stuff, which is, what is the last book you read or box set you watched?
Right, okay. So the last book I read was probably about 20 years ago.
Right. Oh, we just mentioned you fall asleep when you read a book.
But it was The Godfather. I read, it was the last book I read.
Right.
And the book before that was probably was Stephen King, Desperation, I think. But I don't read, I'll be honest with you. Sure. I don't read at all. I'm a bit lazy. I like to sit and watch TV and stuff like that.
In terms of box sets, what, anything that you've particularly watched, anything you like to watch on TV that you can tell us about?
Right. What am I watching? I'm watching that Lock and Key at the moment. Right. I don't know if you've seen that.
I've seen that. What's that about?
They're in this house. They've just moved to this house, and it's got magical keys that do all different things. Ones, I think I've got to a point where once there's an anywhere key where you put it in the door and you can go anywhere, you know, in the world. There's one that you put in the back of your neck and it opens up your mind, and then you can actually get in and you actually sort of walk into your own mind and you can see stuff from the past and that, you know, like memories and things like that. Mm-hmm. And there was another one, which is a mirror key, which was not very nice. You walk through the mirror, but it's like a trap, that key, so it's not a very nice one. But I like things like that. I like things like that, you know, like Harry Potter, anything magical, that sort of thing. I mean, I love Supernatural, but that just went on for a bit too long, and things like that. My other thing is, which is totally different from spirituality, is I love zombies.
Right, okay.
I love zombies, so Walking Dead, that sort of thing, you know. I love watching things like that, and I started watching Walking Dead from the beginning, actually, because the first few series was really good. So... yeah, so anything sort of magical, mystical, or with zombies in.
Right, I see. It's right up your street. Well, that's great to hear all that stuff, and listeners obviously love to hear all the things that our interviewees are kind of reading and watching as well. Well, we're just about out of time now. So just like to say, it's been fantastic to have you on the show today, Richard, on Psychic Social. But before we let you go, can you tell us where people can find you, the best ways to get in contact with you? So your website, social media, anything else that you're currently selling or?
Okay, so to find me, you can go on www.richardmorleymedium.co.uk. And to be honest, if you just type in Richard Morley Medium on Google, I'll come up straight away. So you can do that. I've also got a Facebook page, which is the same thing, Richard Morley Psychic Medium and Health Intuitive. You'll find me there. The one thing I would say is that also you'll find me, because if you follow Nikki, you'll find me all over there as well, because we sort of talk about each other a lot on there. But I would say the one thing I'd like people to look at, if possible, is the show that's coming up with me and Nikki, which is called The Power of Two, because it's both of us going up on stage. I think it's going to be really special, and I think that's going to be really fun as well. I'm really looking forward to that. A little bit nervous, but I'm really looking forward to that. So if you can have a little look at that, I'm sure you'd quite enjoy that.
Tell us where that's going to be, what the dates, are there any tickets left for that?
Yeah, so... that's at Ambleside in Southend. Local for me. It's going to be a good one for Nikki because she's been away from the Essex scene for quite a long time. That's kind of where, obviously where she started because she's an Essex girl originally, but she lives in Devon now. So as soon as we went live with that a couple of days ago, it went a bit nuts, to be honest, and we sold about sort of 2/3 of the tickets within like 24 hours, basically.
Wow. Okay.
So but there is still tickets available for that. Like I say, that's going to be a great show because if you've seen any of our shows that we do online, you'll see that the energy is good. We have a laugh as well. It's not just about, you know, getting the messages out there. We do have a laugh, and that's why I'm looking forward to it, because it's going to be a nice, relaxed sort of, you know, sort of show. We don't sort of put pressure on ourselves to be anything different than what we are, if you know what I mean.
Right.
We just, it's our personalities, that's the way we are, you know. So it's going to be good. It's going to be really enjoyable, that one. So
right, okay.
Check that one out.
And how much are the tickets for that?
They're $16.50. It's on the 1st of May, which is a Friday. But it's, like I say, it's well worth it. It's going to be quite a long show as well, because it's two of us doing it.
And all the details for that on your website, is that right?
Yeah, it's all on my website. Like I say, you'll find it all over Facebook as well, right. But it's all on my website.
And your shows that you do online with Nikki, are they on YouTube? Whereabouts can we find them?
I think there's one that's been saved on YouTube, because after the trolling thing, we decided that we'll stick to Facebook.
Right, okay.
all the videos have actually been saved on Facebook as well, sort of on my Facebook and on Nikki's as well.
Okay, so people can go there and have a look.
Yeah, they can have a look,
okay,
yeah.
Great. Okay, well, I think that's about it now. So thank you very much, Richard, for joining us. And it's been lovely to speak with you today on Psychic Social. And hopefully we can have a catch up with you again on another show at some point in the future, maybe a part two where we can deep dive into something with you. That'd be great.
Yeah, no, I'd love that. I've really enjoyed it. Thanks.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Richard. And take care. We'll see you soon.
Lovely. Cheers.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for joining us on Psychic Social from psychic.co.uk, the spiritual home of psychics.